All right, what's up? Good morning, everybody. Happy, what do we got? Happy Thursday. So coming at you live. I'm sorry I'm so early. I'm aware that very few folks are going to be able to be on. I think it's about 5:35 my time. I have another presentation I'm doing. My brother's actually teaching a class up in Michigan Tech, a pre-PT course. So I'm jumping into his class at 6 o'clock my time. So I've got to knock this out and then hop on that call. So what I want to chat about today is a direct request. So I had a good friend and colleague ask me recently, you know, Jeff, would you give some tips on teaching? You know, you're out there quite a bit doing that and reflecting on it. And would you mind just kind of giving a few things that maybe you wish somebody would have told you a few years ago that you have found to be really important that I could take into my career? My buddy's just kind of starting diving into the teaching world. And so I thought, absolutely. And this would be a good venue for that because we do occasionally talk about, you know, how to organize a presentation. Because when we talk about teaching, we're not just talking about, you know, weekend courses or informalized academia. I would say more importantly, we're talking about educating the public, educating different groups or healthcare providers, educating your patients. So the ability to structure a message and really have that hit home and be of some use, I think is an extremely important one. So I'm gonna just, there's a million things I want to say on this, but maybe we can do a part one and part two. But I'll bring up three things I think are really essential, and then maybe we can have some dialogue in Facebook and kind of see where the conversation goes. So the first thing is that regarding structure, framing is critical, right? People learn so much better when you build a trunk from which to hang the branches, right? From which to extend the branches. But you've got to have a trunk. Like, you've got to have that central theme in that central organization, or people don't feel mentally connected to where they're going and why they're going there. So there's that old adage that I think has stood the test of time for a good reason. And that is, tell them, right? Tell them what you're going to tell them. Tell them and tell them what you told them, right? So when you're thinking about the way you're going to go about your lecture or your presentation, right, you want to tell the audience what you're going to tell them. You want to go ahead and tell them, and then you want to tell them what you told them, right? The reason being, the brain needs, just like the body does, a good dynamic warm-up, right? A good solid session and a good solid cool down. Right? So you want to think about how does that go regarding a presentation? So if you're presenting to a group of folks in your community, right, and you want to talk about back pain, and it's going to be a couple hour lecture, right? Part of that framing might be, you know, folks, in the next hour, we're going to talk about the utility of MRI findings, right? Are they useful? Are they possibly harmful, right? Do they guide conservative treatment? Do they guide surgical treatment? We're going to answer all of those questions here in the next hour because they're very important to how you go about making some key decisions in your life, right? That really whets the palate for that individual in the audience about, okay, what am I about to learn, right? It's that dynamic warm-up for the mind. Then go ahead and give them all the information, and then make sure you circle back around and tell them what you told them. I would say that is the part that most people miss, because most folks have some sort of an introduction dialed up and then they deliver content. But I would argue the most important part is circling back around and telling people what you told them, right? So for our MRI folks, right, that might wind up being, you know, so there's a few rock solid things we can take away from the evidence, right? One being that individuals who have a lot of abnormal findings, right, are individuals who are asymptomatic, have abnormal findings at very high prevalence, right? So in other words, folks, simply having abnormal findings on your imaging should not preclude you from being able to improve with conservative treatment or other treatment. Right, so that would be a very reasonable takeaway. Now, mind you, you've already told them that during the content section, and now you're giving them repetition. Repetition is the thing that people crave the most that they would deny craving. If I've learned one thing in my time teaching, that would be a solid takeaway. People crave repetition, even if they don't know it. Now, the people who know it are going to be your absolute best learners. Right, your absolute best learners know the importance of repetition. They want repetition. They will routinely go to the same course over and over again because they know the value of deepening their learning and picking up the subtleties. Folks who aren't great learners will often deny they want repetition. They will say things like, "Yeah, man, I already heard that. Like, I don't need to hear that again." Right? The absolute best learners, right? Their mind never goes in that direction. What they think is, oh, great, I heard that once, but I know hearing it again would really help. right? What I would argue is everybody benefits from repetition. Whether they know it or not, right, everybody benefits. So your chance at the very end there to wrap up and tell them what you told them is your chance to basically repeat what you said during the content session, say it a bit different, and now maybe say it in a larger context, right, and repeat it back to them. And I promise you, when they hear it that second time, it's gonna drive a lot deeper. Because now they have more supporting information as well. And now you circle back around and you say, one of the things I really want to make sure you took away from this was that individuals who don't have back pain have a high prevalence of abnormal findings. So if that's you or that's a loved one, I really hope that that helps to drive your overall decision making. Right now, you already told them all the stats and all the research about that. Now you've come around and you've retold them, but you've done it more in context and you've done it more emotionally, right? You've done it with more why behind you, and you've probably done it with less facts and figures. So the overall straightforward message had more impact. So making sure that you frame your discussions and presentations with that, tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them. When you do that, they will walk away feeling like they got it, if you will, in a much, much deeper way. Now, if you're doing a weekend seminar, if it's like multiple days, you're going to want to look at that format, tell them what you're going to tell them what you told them. You're going to want to look at that both globally and from a micro level. So at the beginning of the weekend, you're going to want to say, hey, we're going to talk back pain over the next couple days, right? And here's really how we look at back pain, right? We look at subgrouping. We look at these interventions. I want you guys to understand what we're about to dive into, and then we're going to jump into each of those individual content areas. But when you go into each content area, you want to frame that micro as well. So when you go into talking about interventions for back pain, right, you want to say, okay, over the next hour, right, we're going to talk about how we intervene and why, right, on each individual presentation of back pain. We're going to talk about that TBC, treatment-based classification, how it's in its infancy, how it's evolving, how we utilize that along clinical pattern presentation and recognition to really decide what the most impactful presentation or intervention can be at any given point in time. So you want to give at the beginning of the weekend that really big picture. And then every time you go to dive into an individual content area, you want to frame at a micro level. All right, guys, now we're going into this part of the talk, right? And here's what we're going to cover specifically. And then again, go ahead and tell them, and then wrap up and tell them what you told them. So think about that concept. Think about it globally and think about it at the micro level. And one thing I really want you guys to take away is people need repetition whether they know it or not. Generally speaking, the better your learner, the more avid your learner, right, the more they know they need repetition. The more novice the learner, the more they don't appreciate it. But in either case, when they get it, it's going to be of great value. So your chance to wrap things up at the end and give that summary, that is your chance to feed in repetition to really deepen that learning and drive home that experience to make it actionable. So that would be point number one, is really focusing on framing the lectures that way. The second thing that I didn't realize until I think much further down the road is the importance of the question and answer session. So I would argue nowadays that the Q&A really drives the overall impact factor of anything you're presenting. And the reason is simple, right? When you go to give a presentation, you're sitting at your house, right? Or you're sitting in the airport or whatever, putting together this presentation. What you're really doing is you are trying to guess what you believe that audience is going to benefit from hearing. I mean, that's the reality, right? You're trying to figure out who are these people, right? How can I help them? And how can I frame it in a way that actually transforms their behavior? But you are guessing. There's no getting around that, right? You're trying to think, what can I put in here that would make a difference? However, during the Q&A, when you bring in the individuals in the audience, right? When you say, guys, you've heard some information here, right? Do you have any questions, right? Do you have any questions specifically about how this information might work in your actual world day to day? When they say, hey, Jeff, well, I see a lot of these patients, and how is that relevant for these patients? Now we're talking. Now I have a direct IV. I got a main vein right into their world. And I can now say, okay, that is a great question. So the way that what we just presented, the way it works for that person that I have seen historically is A, B, and C. And now that person walks out and they're going to see that patient Monday at 10:30. And you can be damn sure that they're going to be able to actually utilize the information you presented because you framed it inside of their context. You told them not what you thought they wanted to hear. You answered the question about what they needed to hear. And those are very, very different things. Even if they are only one really small step removed, right? It's amazing, you guys, how one little gap between information and action, how one little gap disrupts that process. It's why carryover and transformation is so hard. Their questions close that gap. Their questions are your bridge to answering that one thing that was going to stop them from actually utilizing the material you were presenting in their clinical practice, or for the individuals in the public, actually utilizing the information that you gave to drive their decision making, right? Or drive their steps forward. So it is those little questions of, yeah, but Jeff, in my clinic blank, or yeah, but the person I'm working with had this comorbidity, right? And they were going to not use the information until you said, oh, well, don't worry about that. And here's why. Now that person went from interested to actionable. Two very different people. So realize, hey, what's up, Tracy? Great to see you. Thank you. So realize that Q&A is what really transforms from you guessing what the audience wants to hear, from them telling you what they need to hear for your presentation to be valuable in their transformation. And that is a gigantic gap. Now, I want to say one more thing about this. When you do get some questions going, and I realize, you guys, it can be hard to get the first one, but do realize once you get one, you're rolling. Never before in a class have I gotten one question and all of a sudden after that it was crickets. It never works like that. It's oftentimes crickets at the beginning. But once one person asks a question and you clearly are very receptive to it, you're clearly, your body language shows you're happy they asked, right? Everybody else opens up after that. And now you're in business, right? Because now you're getting an idea of where everyone's coming from. It's getting much more interactive. The real beauty is now people are answering each other's questions, right? Like you're facilitating conversation from different areas. Now you have went from somebody standing on the stage talking to people to a group of individuals who are engaged, having a conversation and sharing like experience. Now we're learning. Like we're going to walk away from this better. All of us. Now, the greedy thing from the instructor's standpoint is now you're learning too. And that's one of the best things about teaching is sometimes you can hijack the learning and bring yourself into the process, because once everyone else is talking, now you've got this wealth of information of caring people who are teaching each other and teaching you. Now something special is taking place. That for all of those reasons, it's why the Q&A is so important. The last comment I want to make though is, you know, be patient. Right? Be willing to wait some awkwardness to get that very first question, because once you get one, you're gold. Once you do get one, you got to follow the one breath rule. The one breath rule. Okay, so take this with you. When someone's asking you a question in your audience, you need to follow the one breath rule. And what that means is you wait until you believe they have completed their entire question and you inhale and exhale in silence. Okay, so what I'm saying is someone's asking you a question, right? You know, hey Jeff, you know, what if somebody has a fusion? How do you alter manual therapy? You know, specifically, would you do joint mobilizations a level above? You think the question's over, take a breath in, take a breath out, and then answer. The reason I'm saying that is as presenters, myself included, we have a horrible tendency to cut people off who are asking us questions. And nothing could say I don't want questions from anybody else more clearly than cutting people off who are asking questions. Now, we're doing it for all the right reasons, right? So the problem is there's usually a knowledge gap, well, there should be, between you and the audience, at least in the specialty content area that you're presenting. So when they're asking the question, you've either usually heard it before or you're so sure you can deliver value that you start jumping in before they're done. It just sets a horrible precedent. First of all, it's obviously bad listening in general, but it sets a terrible precedent for how you value their questioning. You're doing it for all the right reasons. You're so excited they asked. You want to give them good information. But what you've really done was took back over the microphone after you've already had it for like an hour, right? And you've talked to these folks, and now this person talked for 15 seconds, and you jumped right on top of them. And it just makes it look like you are awfully eager to be the one to continue talking, when in reality, you've opened up a golden moment where someone's contributing to the conversation and you've stepped all over them. Again, it's never out of malice. It's because you're pretty sure you know what they're saying and you want to give them the answer as fast as possible. What I'm encouraging you to do, instead of doing that, is take a deep breath, right? So once you think their question's over, give yourself enough pause that you can inhale and exhale. And if indeed they haven't said anything else, now jump in and answer. It just shows a very different level of respect. What it shows is an actual real curiosity to make sure you've heard exactly where they're coming from. And like we've said, that is where all the value is knowing where they're coming from. So make sure you give them that time and show that respect. If you do that, everybody else is going to perceive this person really wants to hear questions. And once they perceive that, the discussion gets lively, it gets engaging, it gets so much deeper and richer than you as an individual presenter with one phase of experience and one perspective could ever hope to provide. All right, the last thing I'll say, I know I'm going kind of long, I knew this one was going to be an issue. The last thing I want to say before I bail is embrace the peak end theory. Embrace the peak end theory. So I'm pretty sure everybody knows what it is, right? But the general 30,000 foot view of the peak end theory is that the way somebody walks away, right? The way somebody walks away and feels about an interaction or about a presentation really comes from the peak and the end. In other words, right, there can be a lot of ups and downs and ebbs and flows, and there should be. I mean, if you're, it's a whole weekend, it's going to be an experience, right? You can't run it hot the whole time. It's, you've got to give and take an ebb and flow, but you do want there to be one or two moments during that lecture where you went all in. Right, there should be moments where in your mind you are feeling yourself taking all of your poker chips and shoving them into the middle and saying, right now, I'm going all in, all full throttle, right? All emotion, all everything I have, I'm about to give it to you. You want to find opportunities like that, but you don't want the whole conference to be like that. This is coming from a guy who used to more or less try to do a whole conference like that. It's not valuable. When you run the RPM, when you run the revolutions hot the whole time, all you wind up doing is making none of it salient. Because it sometimes it's fun to listen to that because it's engaging and it's certainly intense. It keeps your attentions, but it doesn't allow things to stand out. That's the problem. When you really look at what you're trying to do, you're trying to frame a conversation so a few really key points stand out and become actionable. Well, if everything sounds the same, it's very, very hard to make that happen because the content doesn't so much make it happen. The nonverbals, the tone, the engagement, those things make it happen. When you allow there to be some natural highs and lows, so a lot of you who've been to my courses, you guys are probably laughing, listening to this. So after lunch, for example, I always turn all the lights off. I encourage everyone to yawn, right, to relax. I have had people half fall asleep, right? Now that's a bit far, but what I'm saying is I want the emotions of the room to ebb and flow, right? At 1 p.m., after we had a big lunch, I want you guys to ramp down. I'll entertain you for a half hour. Let your food digest, right? Semi-disengage. Like, I need you to ebb and flow because I'm going to, in a moment, when the time is right, right, and the content is important, we are going to ramp this up and try to speak very deep to you with a very, very intense conversation. But I won't have the ability to do that if I didn't respect that beforehand by backing off the throttle so I could step on it. So what I'm saying is, when you're given your lecture, don't feel every single second of it has to be a 10 out of 10 energy. Realize you can ebb and flow, but also realize you want to hit some really intense highs. And at the end, you want to wrap it up. And not only wrap it up, but you want to, at the very, very end of the lecture, you want to repeat the highest points and you want to wrap them in emotion, right? One of my favorite Tim Flynn sayings is that data doesn't change behavior. Data doesn't change behavior. It has taken me forever to fully believe that because I want to believe it should. I want to believe that good information, relevant, salient information, well delivered, right? That should matter. That should change the way people behave, right? It doesn't, right? Data doesn't change behavior. It certainly changes thinking, but it doesn't necessarily change behavior. What changes behavior is emotion. So what I'm encouraging you, in accordance with the peak end theory, in accordance with the repetition theory we talked about earlier, what I'm saying is at the end of your session, the very, very end, whether it's a 2-hour lecture with the public or whether it's a weekend seminar with your colleagues, at the end, wrap up repetition with emotion. Wrap up repetition with emotion. So it's at the end where you want to say, guys, thank you, first of all, for listening. Like, the fact that you care enough to be here matters to me, right? And first of all, I believe that at the bottom of my heart. Second of all, that's an emotional connection. Like, you looking at the audience and saying, to give a weekend like this, to get better, to serve the individuals we're responsible for moves me in a very, very serious way. Like acknowledging what they have put forth, the effort, the heart, the time, the attention, right? Acknowledging that, right? And then letting them know why it matters so much. We can do better. We have to do better. The consequences of us failing conservative care are unacceptable, right? For us to allow people to go to more invasive interventions, for us to allow people, because we have failed them, because we could not deliver, because we were not sharp enough, for us to fail and have them go on to reap the side effects of more invasive interventions, more addictive medication, to allow that to happen is a failure of us, not the system, right? When you bring those kind of messages at the end of your talk, it just creates a depth of emotion that makes people go home and say, you know what? I am going to change what I'm doing. Now your content went from being interesting and accurate to actionable. And that, my friends, is the goal of teaching. To get someone to walk away changed. And it's all these different variables, right? It's the way you frame it. It's respecting their questions. It's following the peak end rule. It's wrapping repetition in emotion. All right, I got to get out of here. I got a lecture for Michigan Tech in 2 minutes. Guys, great seeing you. Hey, Ice Sampler, next weekend. I know everyone's been talking about it. My whole team is going to be there. 9 faculty, Las Vegas, RJ's Clinic. Just come learn, come work out, come have a great time, come explore. I hope to see you all. I am out of here. I'm off to my next lecture. Cheers, guys. Thank you.